The world of tiny animals is a fascinating one. Here you can find a diversity that simply wouldn't be possible on any higher level. A seemingly endless supply of resources, the multitude of all kinds of microecosystems, and the amplified randomness of Mother Nature allow for life to develop in ways one can hardly imagine. The incredible diversity in flora and fauna caused countless animals to develop sophisticated strategies for survival and reproduction that you can only find here. A particularly gruesome reproductive strategy is employed by flies of the genus Cydacteon. Without a closer look, these flies don't seem to be very special or interesting. Only between 1 to 2 mm big, between 1/10th and 1/20th of an inch, about as big as a fruit fly, with comparably large eyes and a predominant humped back that gave the family of these flies the common name humpback flies, most people probably wouldn't even take note of them. Only during egg deposition do they reveal their dark secret. These flies inject their eggs into living hosts, more specifically into ants. Each species of these flies is almost always restricted to a single ant genus, most of the time even to a single ant species. To insert their roughly 100 to 300 eggs, female flies look for potential victims at disturbed mounds or foraging trails. After identifying a target, the female goes into position, hovering a few millimeters above the ant. She is only as big as the ant's head, but as swift as an arrow. In less than a second, she strikes the ant with her ovipositor, the elaborate shaped stinger, inserting a single egg into the worker's thorax. Then she flies off looking for her next target. After a few days, the egg hatches and the larva migrates to the ant's head, where it first feeds on the big muscles that ants use to open and close their powerful pincers, and then proceeds to devour the rest of the head's contents, including the tiny brain, causing the ant to wander aimlessly for 1 or 2 weeks, until it eventually dies of thirst. At this point, the larva, now filling up almost the entire head cavity, is ready to pupate. Next, it releases a chemical that degrades the membranes that hold the ant's exoskeleton together and causes the head to fall off. This fact earned these flies the common name ant-decapitating flies. The next stage, the pupal development, takes an additional 2 to 3 weeks. During this time, the pupa remains protected in the head capsule, completing its metamorphosis into a fly. At last, the adult stage is reached and the fly emerges from the oral cavity and flies into the world. Interesting also, the sex of the fly isn't determined by chromosomes, but the size of the ant's head. Larvae that develop inside bigger heads develop into females, while larvae inside the heads of smaller workers develop into males. The total development time is 4 to 12 weeks, depending on the temperature. The adults, however, only live for around 3 to 5 days, before they once again lay eggs and die. As horrifying as this way of reproduction might seem, it might actually be useful to us. Among the numerous species of ants these flies parasitize are also several species of fire ants, including the invasive red and black imported fire ants in the United States, which were both accidentally introduced from South America in the early 20th century and are now major pests in the US, especially in the southern states. Because they have no real natural enemies in North America, they were able to spread and multiply rapidly to the point that there are now more introduced fire ants in North America than there are fire ants in South America, where they originally came from. In Texas alone, they are causing $1 billion in damages every year. In an attempt to control their spread, researchers began introducing ant-decapitating flies from South America in Texas. While the parasitism rates have been documented to be very low, below 3%, the presence of these flies have been shown to severely interrupt fire ant foraging, leading to a dramatic short-term decrease in resource retrieval. Just one or two flies are enough to trigger an immediate defensive and evasive behavior of a whole colony. 6 different species of these flies, each to combat one specific ant species, have been released at numerous sites across the southern United States since 1999. And despite the initial concerns that introducing another non-native animal is like fighting fire with fire, it didn't yet have unintended consequences. The fact that these flies are highly host-specific, only attacking ants from a single species or a group of closely related species, ensures that the introduced flies only attack the intended fire ant species, and don't negatively impact native ants or other animals. Because these flies are parasitoids that rely on the ants for reproduction, they will of course never completely wipe them out. But they could at least be an effective way to control the population by creating an equilibrium between host and parasite. Determining whether this actually works in practice will, however, take more time, perhaps as much as a decade.